works. Great.
And it works.
Thank you very much, Rebecca. And thank you, Scott, and the other organizers for inviting me here today. It's a pleasure to be giving this talk. A few caveats before I start. This talk is based on a public talk I gave several times, which was an hour-long talk. I've got a half an hour today, so it's going to be a little bit more compressed. I've left some things out. You'll also notice that it's solar-centric. I realize the audience I'm talking to, so bear with me. I was a solar physicist, anyway, by training. And thirdly, I realize I'm talking to a room full of historians like myself, in a sense, so if I have any omissions or errors, please come up to me afterwards and let me know. This is a work in progress. So let's dive right in. Let's go back to the 18th and 19th centuries and look at some of the images of the aurora from those periods of time. What you see on the left is the geodetic expedition to Lapland by Pierre Maupertuis. He is the inventor of the principle of least action, by the way. He was also a very active experimentalist, and in this case, a geodetic explorer. He's actually measuring the shape of the Earth there with sticks up in the Scandinavian Arctic. And you can see in the background the aurora, of course. Interesting to note that from 1736, and I don't know that this was made in 1736, but probably pretty close, 1736 to 1868, when Elias Loomis was writing about weather and thinking that the aurora might be a weather phenomenon, you can see the data taking has not changed in 150 years. They're still drawings, okay? So that was the knowledge of the aurora was very sparse, if any quantitative knowledge did exist. The data were drawings. And you can go even farther back. In 1580, you can look at etchings from Augsburg, Germany in this case, in which you can clearly see the aurora was treated back then as a cosmic sign and a quasi-religious occurrence. And so for millennia, really, human beings have been struggling to understand this phenomenon and even capture it. Today, however, we have a plethora of beautiful images of the aurora, photographs that show us exactly what it looks like in all its different colors and forms. This was back on 17th of March, the St. Patrick's Day severe geomagnetic storm up in Alaska. Very nice picture there with a shooting star involved. And then we can even see movies now taken here, in this case from the ISS. So we live in an age now where we have an absolute plethora of data on the aurora. However, going back to the 1850s, they were starting to get the ability to image and study the aurora more thoroughly, but they still had no idea what was really causing it. They did know, as you can see here, by measuring the Earth's magnetic field, there were links to magnetic storms. When they saw magnetic storms, they would see aurora. And in 1852, Edward Sabine asserted, through studies of statistical relations between magnetic storms and sunspots, that there was some kind of connection between the sunspot cycle and auroral cycles. Now, he was widely challenged on this view because there was no real direct evidence or physics to support that view. And so there really wasn't any sort of clue at all that the sun was involved in the aurora until perhaps if you look at September 1st, 1859, where in Redhill, Surrey, England, an astronomer named Richard Carrington made his daily observations of the sun, and on this day saw these large sunspots suddenly flash out with this great white light that he'd never seen before. This was about 11:20 a.m. local time. Story is he ran out to find somebody to say, you know, come in and verify. By the time he got back, it was gone. But he did record it. He made his recordings known. He was a very respected astronomer at the time, so people took him very seriously. These are the white light flare kernels that he recorded in his drawing. Of course, another astronomer at the time, Richard Hodgson, also observed this, so there were two observers who correlated this observation. It was taken seriously. A sudden magnetic jump was later found to have occurred about the same time as the flare. We now call those the sudden impulse. They call it the solar flare effect back then. And approximately 17 and a half hours later, a huge magnetic storm ensued. This is the Kew Observatory magnetic trace again, September 2nd, this time in the evening, 1859. The storm was detected all over the world. This is the Kolaba Observatory in Bombay, India, in which on the around local time of noon there, they had a huge magnetic disturbance. And these are recordings of auroral sightings at the time. You can see aurora was clearly sighted in Honolulu and all the way down to Venezuela. Truly an incredible magnetic storm that had not been seen in modern times at that time. This is a nice quote that I like to show because this was recorded down in San Salvador. And it says, the red light was so vivid that the roofs of the houses and the leaves of the trees appeared as if covered with blood, showing that this was an incredibly bright electron, red electron aurora, as we now would call it. Now, afterwards, there was a lot of discussion. Again, did Carrington's flare cause this? Was there a connection? Balfour Stork, who was at that time the head of the Kew Observatory, had this quote in a very carefully worded statement, because he was a very careful scientist. He was the director of an observatory, after all. And he said, it would perhaps be wrong to consider this in any other light than a casual coincidence. But then he quotes, Sabine has proved that a relation subsists between magnetic disturbances and sunspots, so it is not impossible to suppose that in this case our luminary was taken in the act. So that's a very carefully worded statement to say, yeah, we think there could be a connection here. Sabine has shown a correlation statistically. Now we have this observation of what they didn't even call a flare back then. It's also nice to note that this paper that he presented to the Royal Society was on the Great Magnetic Disturbance, which extended from August 28th to September 7th. So a lot of people say, oh, the Carrington event's a flare. It happened on September 1st. Actually, there was a very large geomagnetic storm on the 28th of August, and the perturbations extended all the way to the 7th of September. So when you think of a Carrington event occurring again, this is not a one-day affair. These are week-long things that we have to be thinking about. Anyway, George Airy, Astronomer Royal from 1835 to 1881, very well-respected astronomer at the time, very strong intellect, clearly refuted this. He came out and he said, this is hogwash. He took the Kew Observatory terrestrial magnetism traces and he did his own statistical studies and said there is absolutely no 12-year cycle in these data that I can see. I see about a 6 to 6.5 year cycle. Therefore, I propose that there is no connection between the sunspot cycle and the magnetic cycle, and that Sabine is wrong. What he was seeing was the upswing and the downswing of the cycle, you tend to get more magnetic storms. So he had discovered, actually, the upswing and downswing magnetic storm cycle, but because it was half of the solar cycle, he said, there you go. There's no correlation. A lot of people really responded to that and said, yeah, I think you've got a point, and began to doubt both Carrington and Balfour Stork. Another giant of the time, Lord Kelvin, very mathematical man. He used math. He said, okay, let's calculate the energy in a terrestrial magnetic storm. We can do that. We can assume that the sun is the source. Let's say that the sun does the most magnetically radical thing it can and reverses its field suddenly and propagates that out into space. 93 million miles away is the Earth. The amount of energy that would cause, that it would take to cause the terrestrial magnetic storm that we measure, means that solar energy would have to be the output of the sun, the entire sun, over several months, taking place in several hours. And that's just incomprehensible. We don't see any change in the sun. There's no way this could happen. Of course, those are bad physics. He was assuming it was an isotropic effect. So if it's isotropic over a 93 million mile sphere, of course. But back then, of course, they had no idea what could possibly transmit something from the sun to the Earth, especially something magnetic. Fast forward to 1897, we get into J.J. Thomson discovering cathode rays are actually particles called electrons eventually. This began to be interesting because now you had something that could travel through free space and be an electrical current source, and therefore a magnetic source. In 1900, Kristen Birkeland was the first to say, okay, I think this could really be something. He proposed that the electrons from the sun could be a cause of the aurora. He had no idea how the electrons would get here, how they were created in the sun, but he did experiments, as you can see on the right there, with what he called a Torella, a magnetized sphere shooting cathode rays in, and he noticed that the rays would congregate around the poles, just like the aurora. So he was on the right track, and it was now beginning to become a reality that if we could figure out why or how the sun was able to transmit something electromagnetic towards the Earth, this might actually be an explanation. Finally, in 1908, George Ellery Hale, working at Mount Wilson Observatory in California, used the Zeeman effect, which we heard about yesterday from Bruce Leitz, to do the first definitive detection of magnetic field on the sun in sunspots. So here we have closed the loop to a great degree. We have magnetic field detected on the sun. We have a way for that magnetic field, at least in theory, to get from the sun to the Earth somehow. It still wasn't understood what that mechanism was, but by this time, Lord Kelvin and George Airy were looking like they were on the losing side of the argument. And people began to realize, again, the sun is something we have to pay attention to if we want to understand geomagnetic storming. In the 20s, following World War I, where the Eiffel Tower was primarily used as a radio tower, Giuseppe, I believe it is, Mark Koning, but I could have that wrong, used special antenna that he put up on the Eiffel Tower to begin detecting changes in the Earth's atmosphere which would change the radio reception. And by this time, people had noticed clearly that when there was more activity on the sun in the form of sunspots, radio transmissions would frequently drop out. So there was beginning to be a tie between the sun and atmospheric conditions relative to radio, what we now call the ionosphere. And he said at the time that he was going to start predicting these capabilities. So he really did the first, what we would now call space weather forecast from the Eiffel Tower to tell people that the ionosphere seems disturbed. And he was trying at that time also, and a lot of other people were, to correlate again to the sun. And therefore determine what could possibly be coming from the sun to cause these disturbances. It was really only in the 30s when Sidney Chapman, as we've also heard about several times tomorrow, sat down with Bartles as well and formulated a theory of a magnetic Earth being impinged upon by, in this case, a planar magnetic surface, or volume, if you will, and therefore calculating the disturbance that would ensue. And you can see that they have the basic idea of a reconnection funneling into the polar regions. So now we're getting into theories at which you can begin to understand if something were to come from the sun that were magnetic, this is how it would interact with the Earth's magnetic field. In the 1940s, this is again very relevant to HAO. This is the climax observatory movie of the largest prominence still to this day ever recorded. Largest prominence eruption. The blue dot there is roughly the size of the Earth for scale. Suddenly we have movies of stuff coming off of the sun. The sun is no longer a constant radiative body. It's actually capable of throwing something off. It wasn't really understood what these were at the time. They were called prominences, and then they erupted, and it wasn't clear where they went into space or if they even left the sun entirely. But we're getting some hints. Also in the 40s, as we heard about again yesterday, the corona was studied during eclipses. And through that study, they began to understand that you're looking at a gas in the corona that's not just dust cloud or something like this surrounding the sun. It's actually a million degree plasma. And this is very interesting. It led in the 50s to this man, Eugene Parker, strictly through theoretical thinking about what happens when a million degree gas is in the gravitational field of a star, to propose the solar wind. And the tie here is that is Tom Bogdan's thesis advisor. So we have a direct tie to HAO and back to the solar wind theories, which eventually they were also very contentious at the time. But they were eventually proven to be correct. We now know the sun, as shown on the right in a model, throws off this continual stream of plasma, million degree plasma we call the corona, and it happens in a magnetic sense so that the green and the orange there are two different senses of the magnetic field. And you can see the white dot there sweeping through, that's the Earth, and you can see how that experiences different magnetic fields of the solar wind as the wind changes over it. At this point, the loop was almost closed. It was clear the sun was capable of putting out a plasma, that's electrical field and magnetic field, that it can impinge on the Earth's magnetic field. However, they really still didn't know why these large magnetic storms were caused. This, they could correlate magnetic storms, minor magnetic storms with solar wind changes, but the larger magnetic storms were still a mystery. It wasn't really clear why you would get occasionally these very, very large storms when the solar wind wasn't changing much, as far as they could measure. Moving ahead, this is a nice anniversary to celebrate for us as well. December 1st, 1965 was the first regular daily report and forecast of solar conditions, not just ionospheric conditions like Marconi, but solar conditions, and that was done here in Boulder by the Space Disturbances Forecast Center. That was in support of NASA's Gemini mission. And that's an interesting history as well, because at the time, it's a NASA mission. And so various people approached various people at NASA and said, would you like to do forecasting of the space environment in support of the mission? And basically, they also asked the DOD, the Air Force, and both of those agencies basically said, no thanks, that's not really our bag, we're not forecasting here, we're more concentrating on the spaceflight aspects and the science of the sun, for instance, but the forecast, no. NOAA at the time had the Weather Bureau involved, as I'll show later in some slides. They were the forecasters, they were given the task of forecasting something, in this case, space weather, to support the Gemini mission, and it's been in the NOAA bailiwick ever since, so that's really the start of it. This is a copy of the 201st forecast issued by NOAA back in 1966. And we don't have a copy of the very first one, but we were able to find this one from 1966. Being number 201, we were able to deduce that the first one was on 1st of December 1965. That's what it looked like, teletyped, all capitals. We still kind of do that, actually. And this was the sun on the December 1st, 1965 calcium K image. You can see it was pretty boring. There's a little bit of an active region in the northwest, but not much more. We also have a sunspot drawing from Sacramento Peak Observatory at the time. You can see a little bit of spotting over there again in the northwest. Pretty benign conditions for the Gemini astronauts, and this, I believe, is the Fraunhofer Institute map that was current at the time. So these are all from December 1st, 1965. This is the kind of thing that went into making the very first regular space weather forecast, and we've continued that regular forecasting to this day. So this is really another anniversary we're celebrating here, the 50th anniversary of what various incarnations of the Space Weather Prediction Center from 65 to 2015. Nice thing to note. Still, we're looking for some way to create a large magnetic storm. Solar wind is now understood. However, nothing that can create these sudden impulses and these really large storms is really understood. 1969, this is radio observation showing a plasma cloud, a coherent cloud of plasma or something coming off of the sun. This is not the solar wind. This is something different. Very fuzzy, very low cadence, as you've seen. Finally, in 1971, the NRL scientists used the space-based LEO coronagraph, which we also heard about yesterday, to image on the OSO 7 satellite the first optical image of a CME. They didn't call it a CME back then, a coronal mass ejection. I believe they were coronal transients. There are probably some people in here correct me on that, but this was the first evidence filmed with relatively high spatial and temporal resolution for the time of something coming off of the sun. 1973, we had Skylab. Skylab provided really good data, and aside from the coronal mass ejection studies they did, one of the things that was a definitive discovery on Skylab was coronal holes. Using an X-ray telescope in orbit for the first time, or at least the first constantly monitored time, they were able to show that coronal holes, these large-scale gaps in the corona, were 27-day recurrent features on the face of the sun, and those correlated exactly with the 27-day recurrence in geomagnetic storming that had been seen for centuries, or at least a couple of centuries. People had known for a long time that geomagnetic storms tend to recur on these cycles. Nobody had any idea really why until coronal holes were definitively identified in the Skylab data and shown to be on this 27-day solar rotation period. This is a coronagraph image from the SO52 coronagraph, which is the engineering model is upstairs on the third floor. And you can see by 73, they're getting very good at coronagraph imaging of CMEs. You're beginning to understand more. These are structured things that are coming off. They're loop-like in some sense, but there's a core to them. And in fact, in using data like this and continuing on with things like the SMM, there's the engineering model upstairs. People began to understand this three-part structure of a CME. And here we are today. This is the SOHO coronagraph, LASCO coronagraph, based at the L1 orbit between the Earth and the Sun, constantly monitoring the Earth, or the Sun rather, for eruptions of that kind. And in the middle, you can see an extreme ultraviolet image of the Sun, which shows that we've now understood the entire mechanism of creating a large geomagnetic storm, in this case, the October 2003 large geomagnetic storms. You have on the Sun the flare, the thing that Carrington first saw in optical light. Now with EUV instrumentation, we see those quite often. And associated with that, the coronal mass ejection. Associated with both of those, you have these radiation events, the particles that create the snow on the camera there. That's radiation being pushed ahead of the CME. So by today, we now understand thoroughly that there are sort of two basic ways you can get a geomagnetic storm to form, and therefore the aurora. We've tied the aurora back to the sun definitively through both solar wind changes, when the wind gets fast, when the wind is interacting with different stream speeds, for instance, what we call a co-rotating interaction region, you can get auroral geomagnetic storms and therefore aurora. But the big ones are caused by coronal mass ejections, which are actually magnetic eruptions from the sun with three different aspects to them, the flare, the coronal mass ejection, and the radiation storm, all combined into one sort of three-part effect that takes place on Earth. And that's what we call the large space weather that we work with today. Now here at NOAA today, we take this sort of three-storm aspect of a magnetic eruption and we break it down, and this is how we forecast things today. The first thing we do is when we see a flare, as measured here by the geostationary weather satellite, which has an X-ray sensor looking back at the sun at all times, we see a large, as you can see, increase there in the impulsive level of X-rays. That indicates a flare. Currently, with the knowledge base we're working with, we have no way to forecast flares. We have only a way to alert our customers that there has been a flare. So we have a zero lead time on that, but we do it. Whoops, sorry, wrong direction. The second thing we do, and it's typically what happens, is when this flare occurs on the face of the sun and the coronal mass ejection is launched, the radiation storm is pushed ahead of the coronal mass ejection nearly the speed of light. So typically what you'll see is the next thing after the flare will be a rapid increase in proton radiation, in this case, again, measured at the geosynchronous orbit by the GOES satellite. Another big mystery here, though, is that this is not at all a one-to-one correlation between these large magnetic eruptions and radiation storms. It's one of the big gaps, I think, in our knowledge in being able to predict radiation storms. We don't really know what causes them in relation to the eruption happening on the sun. So there can be very large eruptions on the sun with absolutely no radiation storm. However, if we do see this happening, we can at least watch the relatively slower rise of the radiation towards the dotted line you see there in the middle of the graph, which is the threshold for alert. So we can usually give our customers a warning that the radiation levels are climbing towards threshold, and we can therefore give a warning that something is going to happen. And when it does finally arrive at the geostationary satellite, we measure it there, we give an alert that radiation storm is occurring. With the geomagnetic storm, we can give a watch. As soon as we see a CME come off in the LASCO data, that's when we put out a watch to our customers saying something has actually happened. We then model it. We determine if it's going to come earthward or elsewhere. If it's coming earthward, we put out a watch. Given the speed of the CMEs now, that's anywhere between about 15 hours to 72 hours before this thing arrives at Earth and causes the large geomagnetic storm. So that's, if you hear the term geomagnetic storm watch, that's what it is. It means there's something we think coming this way, but we're not sure exactly when it's going to arrive, or sometimes even if it's going to arrive. When it does arrive at the L1 point, where we have the ACE spacecraft monitoring the solar wind at all times, we can see the signature in the solar wind. At that point, we can issue a warning that yes, indeed, something is coming towards the Earth. This is a geomagnetic storm warning. Given the location of the ACE satellite 1.5 million kilometers upstream from Earth, that gives us about anywhere from 15 to 60 minutes of warning before that plasma cloud essentially hits the Earth. At which point, when it does hit the Earth, we now have real-time monitoring of magnetometers all over the world. This is a trace of a magnetometer, I believe, in possibly Ottawa. And that is when we issue the geomagnetic storm alert and begin putting out estimates of the strength of the storm, and we go into a nowcasting mode. We're not forecasting anymore. We're trying to tell people what's going on with the geomagnetic storm and trying to quantify it with things like the KP index. Okay, that's the basic flow that we're at now with our understanding of space weather and our understanding of how to forecast these various events. And you can see there are very large gaps in our scientific knowledge which are preventing us from doing a better job. The two most significant being, we have no way to forecast a flare, and we really can't tell you if a radiation storm is going to occur with any given magnetic eruption from the sun. We've quantified each of these things, though, in terms of a scale. It's roughly a logarithmic scale based on everything else in the weather service, which seems to be from 1 to 5. So we have a radio blackout, which is the same as a solar flare, because, of course, the major effect of a solar flare, the X-rays ionize the atmosphere and cause that decrease in radio transmission that Marconi was trying to predict. We call that the radio blackout scale. An R5 would be something like an X20 flare, so those are very rare, but they do occur. We have solar radiation storm scale, again, 1 to 5, roughly logarithmic. And then finally, the geomagnetic storm time, geomagnetic storm scale, again, 1 to 5. We have not yet in this cycle had a G5. We've had a couple of G4s, including the March 17th St. Patrick's Day storm. And then finally, what you might notice is it's funny because we've come all this way through history. Marconi was the first one, or his associates, to really try to issue space weather forecasting. They were concentrating solely on the ionosphere. And what's missing here? There's no ionospheric forecast. There's no ionospheric scales. We've gotten very, very solar-centric in our space weather. We're not actually forecasting ionospheric conditions like I think we should be and need to be. We still have people using radio. Communications are very important. This is actually done much more in the United States Air Force, understandably, because they're serving their military customers for communications, but it's something that we will be looking at in the future at SWPC. So just a real quick run-through of how we got to be SWPC. As I mentioned, this is the 50th anniversary, but before that, we started out at the National Bureau of Standards, always in the Department of Commerce, as the Inter-Service Radio Propagation Laboratory, basically working with the military to understand radio communications again. This was all classified work in 1945. It was declassified and became the Central Radio Propagation Laboratory. In 1954, the CRPL moves from Washington, D.C. to Boulder, Colorado. And that move included the Space Environment Forecasting Division. I want to point out right there, that arrow points out Connie Sawyer. Is Connie in the audience today? She was here yesterday, and I got a picture of her with me, because that is to my knowledge, the only person with direct personal experience of the CRPL. still here in Boulder. So it was really great to be able to meet here yesterday and meet somebody from the CRPL, the direct progenitor of the Space Weather Prediction Center. We didn't go straight from CRPL to SWPC, though. In 65, the CRPL merged with the Weather Bureau and the Coast and Geodetic Survey to form what was called ESA back then. This included the Space Disturbances Laboratory and the Forecasting Center, two different things at that time. And as you saw, the Space Disturbances Forecast Center was the Gemini Forecasting Service. And it was interesting to read that one of the reasons that they wanted to merge these things is because at the time, the Weather Bureau wasn't doing very well forecasting the weather. And in fact, the CRPL was doing a really good job forecasting the ionosphere. And they felt that the CRPL were the more professional forecasters in a sense. They really knew their business. The Weather Service needed help. And so they merged them with the CRPL and the Coast and Geodetic Survey to form ESA. This, of course, became, in 1970, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA. At that time, the SDL became the Space Environment Laboratory, SEL. Don Williams was the director. The SDFC became the Space Environment Services Center, and Bob Decker was the director. So you had sort of two directors up on the hill working towards space environment services. Also around that time, I'm not sure it was actually 1970, but around that time, Bob Decker and Don Williams were in discussions with the Air Force for them to become operational space weather centers as well to back us up. 1986, the SEL director Ernie Hildner took over, and he was the director until his retirement in 2005. He also went through the name change from SEL in 1995 to the Space Environment Center. In 2005, the SEC became part of the National Weather Service. Sort of in a reverse of the earlier story, they came in and they said, no, you really need to get better at forecasting. We're going to come and teach you how to really do forecasting. That was became a much more high-profile effort for us then. As you can see here, our forecasters were beginning to do things like the Weather Channel and become much more a part of the day-to-day knowledge of the weather enthusiasts, which I think was a very good thing. At that time, SEC became the Space Weather Prediction Center. And then finally, or not finally, but in 2007 to 2012, SWPC Director Tom Bogdan led the center. In 2014, we welcomed our UK Met colleagues as the second civilian 24/7, 365 operational Weather Service. This is the Weather Service building in Exeter, UK, a part of which now does space weather 24/7 like SWPC, the only other center in the world that does that. And then finally on myself in 2014, taking over as the director. Real quick, the future. A couple of slides on the future. We have new observations coming up. We have Discover. What? 1 minute, all right. Running through the new discoveries and our new observations in 1 minute. You can see here we're looking forward to some major satellite augmentation. We have new models coming online. We have the solar wind and sun and aurora models operational currently. All of the models in the middle there, the ionosphere, the magnetosphere, the thermosphere, and the ground e-field are models coming online in the near future or very near future or slightly farther future. We've gotten a $1.5 million plus up in our budget specifically to transition those research models into operations of space weather forecasting. And then finally, we also have the National Space Weather Strategy. This was an effort undertaken in the Office of the President, the OSTP, to develop a space weather strategy for the nation to respond to an extreme event, because it was discovered in looking at this that while we understand these phenomena quite well and we have a basic way of forecasting most of it, we are not prepared as a nation to respond if SWPC says, okay, by the way, there's a Carrington event that's going to arrive in about 12 hours. We don't have a systematic way as a nation to respond to that imperative. So this was a national strategy undertaken, which includes, as the name implies, both enhancing operations and enhancing research. So as we all know, understanding is the bedrock foundation of prediction. If we don't understand the phenomenon, as I showed earlier, the history shows you're not going to predict anything correctly. So operations, research, and then mitigation is the effort undertaken mostly by the Department of Homeland Security to get the infrastructure operators ready to respond to an extreme event and also to prepare an extreme event should damage occur during that event. This is something that will roll out later this year, and Bill Murtaugh will talk about that more this afternoon. And that's it. Thank you very much.